Chris Mariello, Director of the Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies, Salem State University.
Welcome to the live stream of the Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies annual commemoration of the Holocaust. We are coming to you live from Temple Emmanuel in Marblehead. We are so pleased that you could join us. There is a closed captioning option on the bottom of your screen, but due to the stream, the closed captioning may be a few seconds behind the speaking. Please join me for the Star Spangled Banner.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight. For the ramparts we once were so gallantly streaming, and the rocket's red glare, the bombs bursting in air, gave proof through the night that our flag was still there. Oh, say does that star-spangled for the land of the free and the home of the brave.
Welcome to the Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies annual Yom HaShoah commemoration. My name is Chris Moriello, and I am the director of the center, and I'll be your host for this evening. The center and its predecessor, the Holocaust Center Boston North, have organized and presented Yom HaShoah for 35 consecutive years. When the COVID-19 pandemic struck, we were forced to cancel our entire spring program, including Yom HaShoah. When the dust finally settled, we decided that we owed it to all of you in order to run Yom HaShoah once again. With the imagination, energy, and support of the rabbis and temples of the North Shore, our CJP, ADL, and JCC partners, the hardworking staff at the center, the team of Preston Productions, we were able to put together this program to not mark the Nazi mass murder of 6 million Jews in the Holocaust. I would like to thank you, the viewers at home, and everybody who contributed to making tonight's program possible. Our theme tonight is resilience in the time of crisis. We're reminded of the incredible resilience of the Jews before, during, and after the Holocaust in the face of deep-seated anti-Semitism, ghettoization, deportation, shooting squads, and death camps. Some took arms and fled into the forest to fight as partisans. Others secretly gathered to celebrate Jewish celebrations and religion. Others documented the last days, writing the story of the Jews when German barbarism attempted to destroy the body of the Jews, but also their history too. Their resilience is an inspiration to us now, facing an unknown future. Tonight, we are celebrating the life of the survivor and founder of our center, Sonia Schreiber-Weitz. We are also marking the 10th anniversary of her death in 2010. Many of you knew Sonia. Like you, over the years, I had many conversations with her. I am reminded today of one particular conversation. We were driving home from one of her many public talks to school children across the Commonwealth. I asked her, could she have imagined that 60 to 70 years after the Holocaust, she would still be speaking about those events in her life? And she said, I was young. I thought it was only happening to me and my family. I had no idea about a Holocaust except what was happening to me and my sister Blanca. As a historian of the Holocaust, Sonia's words were profound, as disruptive as they were enlightening. We like to imagine the Holocaust as a collective historical experience. Indeed, the Holocaust was an attempt to destroy the Jewish people as a whole. But the experience of the Holocaust was also immediate. It was also individual and familial. The Nazis and their collaborators destroyed local communities, displaced and deported immediate and extended family members. They killed parents, brothers, sisters, grandparents, nieces, nephews, cousins, and in-laws. The Nazis brought death and destruction to individuals and to the people that they loved. Resilience in times of crisis is also immediate, local, personal, and familial. While in no way equivalent to the horrors of the Holocaust, we gather tonight in our own homes with our loved ones to support them and keep them close during this crisis. We gain strength from each other. We share our weaknesses and hope that we can overcome this crisis. And we will. We will because we can draw on the wisdom of survivors like Sonia White's, because we know that we have infinitely more resources, and because if we all work together, there is nothing that can stop us from overcoming this challenge we can hardly imagine today. At this point, it's my distinct pleasure to introduce Rabbi David Meyer. This event would not have been possible without Rabbi Meyer's immediate and enthusiastic response to my request to use the temple and its resources for tonight's live stream. Rabbi Meyer.
Good evening, friends. Prophet Isaiah called out with his famous words, Shalom, Shalom, l'rachok v'l'karov, greetings of shalom to those both far and near. And so on behalf of Temple Emmanuel, I also want to welcome everyone joining us remotely this evening, those nearby and those from places far and wide. For although the sanctuary is essentially empty, it is nonetheless a special honor to be hosting tonight's observance of Yom HaShoah V'Hagvura, the day of remembrance of the Holocaust and the heroism, of the destruction and the resiliency. Holocaust and Heroism Remembrance Day was established by the Israeli Knesset in 1951. And in fact, this observance and tomorrow's Yom HaZikaron, which has already begun in Israel, the Memorial Day for the fallen soldiers of Israel and the victims of terrorism, these are the only two official memorial days in the state of Israel by law. But tonight, let us consider that for Jews, memory is not merely an occasional practice. In fact, memory is a type of spiritual discipline. From of old, our sages have taught the six remembrances, the episodes in our formative history, which should be recalled on a regular basis as a daily practice. These include, among others, Yetziat Mitzrayim, going out of Egypt, Ma'amad Har Sinai, standing at Sinai to receive the Torah, Ma'aseh Amalek, remembering the evil Amalekites who attacked the most vulnerable, and of course, Zechirat Shabbat, remembering the Sabbath day and elevating it as a day of rest and holiness and joy. So we are urged by our tradition to remember on a daily basis these episodes in our history. And it's not simply for memory's sake alone, but to help refine our personal qualities, our own moral virtues. And so it is, as we in the generations following the Holocaust add another remembrance to our sages' list. And like the six remembrances of our tradition, this seventh remembrance of the Holocaust and the heroism must always be part of our personal as well as national refinement. For remembrance such as we share tonight not only brings honor to the lives of those lost in the Shoah, but also can help guide our moral direction today and into an unmeasured future. Through our remembering, let us learn anew and promise to never become a perpetrator, to never see oneself as a helpless victim, and above all, to never become a bystander to evil. And so I want to thank all of those who've helped in the preparation and who will participate in this evening's program. And I would now invite my colleague and friend, Rabbi Rick Perlman of Temple Ner Tamid in Peabody, to share special reflection on this solemn occasion of our remembrance.
Thank you, Rabbi. I was asked to share reflections. And the moment I was asked to do this, I was immediately drawn back to June 10 years ago, when a phone call came into my former congregation in Warwick, Rhode Island, from a neighbor who said, Rabbi, you have to go outside of your building and look and see what is there. To my horror, I saw a swastika painted right on the front of the building where our name stood. I can't recall exactly how I felt other than completely horrified, frightened, angry, scared. All these different feelings began to rush through me. And as I was about to turn to walk back to the office and call the police and report this heinous crime, I saw a can, a spray can of paint right in the field next to the synagogue with a thumbprint in paint. Right then and there, I knew not only was I going to call the police, but I was also going to call the Providence NBC affiliate, who showed up and took a picture of a can with a thumbprint. Within 30 minutes of the 6 o'clock newscast, two young men, one a juvenile, one an adult, 20 years old, turned themselves in. They knew they had been caught by that thumbprint. That Shabbat went by and I was tormented. What do we do? The people were telling me, throw the book at them, throw the book at them, put them in jail. I was tormented. Throw them in jail, they'll hate us more. Do nothing, they'll hate us more. What do you do? I met with the family, I met with the young men that following week. And they said to me that they thought they were painting graffiti on the temple. And they thought that the swastika was a peace sign. When I looked at them and said, really? You could tell that they weren't telling the truth. As we continued our discussion, I told them that the people in this community want me to throw the book at you. To which one of the men said, you can't do that to me. I want to join the Air Force. I said, you should have thought about that. But the younger boy said to me, Rabbi, you don't seem to be very angry. And I looked at him and I said, young man, I will give you 6 million reasons why I'm more than angry. I am totally frustrated at what you've done. So here is the choice. You may either do jail time, which everybody's pushing for, they want me to throw the book at you, or you can go to the Holocaust Education Resource Center in Providence and volunteer. Because what you did was you did not allow one of our members, Alice Goldstein, to attend shul this Shabbat because her parents' store in Germany was a victim of Kristallnacht, the night of broken glass. And that swastika that you put on this building brought it back to her. And she couldn't worship this weekend. Will you? And they agreed to do the Holocaust education. 6 months later, they stood in front of my congregation. And they, with tears flowing through a crowded synagogue, apologized. But they didn't just say, I'm sorry. They explained why they were sorry, because they were educated. We threw the book at them. We educated these young men. And Alice gave these two men, the Holocaust survivor, handed these two men two saplings, little trees, and said to them, nurture these trees, their life. Watch them grow. Watch them develop. And you are responsible for them. And when they left, I got a phone call from their pastor, a Lutheran minister who I became very dear friends with, And he said, Rabbi, why were you so gentle with these gentlemen? Why were you so easy on them? Why didn't you throw the book at them? And I said, my dear pastor, I threw the book at them. Education. We must teach our children all the time in every curriculum about the Holocaust. We must never forget. We must always educate. It happened. We must not deny it. And we must be sure that children learn of the horrors of the Holocaust. My reflections of Yom HaShoah, evil became good because of education. Let us never forget to educate. And with that, it is my honor now to introduce my dear and beloved colleague and friend, Rabbi David Meyer, who will now light the Shoah candles in memory of those 6 million beloved people who perished in the Shoah.
At this time, I would like to welcome John Keenan, president of Salem State University, to offer his greetings from the university.
Good evening, everyone. I would like to extend my deepest appreciation to everyone who made this meaningful event possible. I'm pleased to be able to join you from my home tonight. I'd like to give a special thanks to Robert Treston, executive director of the Anti-Defamation League, and my good friend, Representative Lori Ehrlich of Marblehead, for being with us. I would also like to thank the combined Jewish philanthropies of Greater Boston, the Anti-Defamation League, and the Jewish Community Center of the North Shore for all of their support. And of course, I must also thank Professor Chris Mariello and Program Director Dan Eschek for their outstanding leadership of the Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies at Salem State. Salem State University and the Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies share a deep commitment to social justice and human rights. We are grateful to all of you for joining us for this important remembrance, even in this new format. As we remember the victims and the survivors of the Holocaust, we must all consider the importance of fighting humanity's challenges in the best possible way. Resilience is today's theme, and rightly so, just as the act of having tonight's event exemplifies resilience. We are reminded today of the nations that failed to protect the Nazis' weakest victims. Many of these nations did not consider it their problem until it was too late. A threat to humanity anywhere is everyone's problem. As the coronavirus ravages our communities and threatens our most vulnerable populations, we must act to protect those who are at the greatest risk, even if we are not among them. As Professor Mariello stated, this pandemic is in no way equivalent to the horror of the Holocaust, but we can draw on the amazing human resilience we have seen in the past to get through this challenge together. Future generations will judge us by our response. Standing together, we can help to protect the weak and marginalized in this time of crisis, and we can continue to finding safe ways to connect with and support one another. Doing so will be crucial to us moving forward as a strong and resilient community. Thank you for being part of this moment of reflection and remembrance.
Thank you, President Keenan. I would also now like to have comments presented by State Representative Lori Ehrlich.
Good evening, everyone. I hope that as we virtually gather this evening, you are still enjoying some nice memories from Passover, and that you're all in good health. Though I really wish we could all be together in person, we all know this is a temporary situation. And when it's safe, we will gather again. Allow me first to thank Chris Moriello and everyone at the Holocaust Center for putting us all together, and to my good friend and former legislative colleague, President John Keenan, for his compassionate leadership at Salem State University. And of course, Rabbi Meyer is the perfect steady spiritual guide for these challenging times. As I'm sure you already know, we have had our local share of the global scourge of anti-Semitism. That awareness comes from gatherings like this and the hard work of the many organizations that educate and activate us to make sure that discrimination, anti-Semitism, and so many other isms never get a foothold to grow. That work has never been so challenging and vitally important to America. In addition to the challenges we were already facing, we are in a strange and potentially dangerous moment. As we try to stay safe from a deadly new virus, we are also frustrated by the isolation and economic downturn that isolation has fostered. As of today, Americans have died, double that of just a week ago. So many of us are also in mourning. There are a few things to keep our eye on, though, as this moment has caused some dark characters in our society to smell weakness. Many see the protests that are popping up throughout the country as an opportunity to spread hate. In Michigan, swastikas and signs saying Heil Whitmer, targeting Governor Gretchen Whitmer, are sprinkled in with Confederate flags and MAGA signs. Ohio featured a sign with a rat wearing a Jewish star saying, quote, the real plague. Reports from overseas are no more encouraging. In France, Switzerland, Iran, Spain, Turkey, and Venezuela, we see scapegoating of Israel and Jews for the creation and spread of coronavirus. As we know, blaming Jews for everything comes from a familiar anti-Semitic playbook with roots in history and, as we know, the Holocaust. This is why it is so important to remember and share. Like no other time in my life have I believed that it can happen again. It is an act of defiance to remember. We must help others remember the lives, the stories, and the humanity of those killed in the Holocaust. As survivors, and we all are, we are duty bound to rededicate ourselves to putting an end to hatred in our world. Tonight, we stand strong and united, facing down the double threat of anti-Semitism and a deadly contagion. We must stay safe, but also not let our guard down. We also stand in Massachusetts, where I'm pleased to report state leaders are working together, as we usually do, for the health and safety of everyone. Our tiny Jewish caucus in the legislature stays connected, stands proud, and we rally our colleagues when we need to, and we're sure to mark every Jewish holiday with a gathering and a nosh. And, you know, all I can say is in our state, we've got you, but we cannot do it alone. I guess in conclusion, I wish you all good health, joy, and God willing, a bright future. Shalom.
Thank you, Representative Ehrlich. We are fortunate tonight to be joined by two prestigious musicians, Aaron Katzenlenbogen and Amir Milstein, who agreed to join us to perform two Israeli pieces for this solemn event. Thank you. Thank you for that beautiful performance. We now move to a very special part of tonight's commemoration. Each year, we pay tribute to the victims of the Holocaust by listening to the testimony of a survivor. Rena Finder has spoken at our events in the past, but her story as of survival as one of Schindler's Jews continues to evoke the reflection that is so important to us tonight. She was scheduled to speak live, but instead we offer a recorded version of her story tonight.
I was 12 years old when we were forced to resettle into the Krakow ghetto. I trembled with such fear and hopelessness as we walked through the narrow, familiar streets into the ghetto, carrying our meager possessions, pulling a pushcart filled with some bedding, a mattress, and some pots and pans. We went over the bridge into our prison behind the high walls, surrounded by armed guards and hundreds of dogs trained to tear us apart. Since adults over 55 and children under 12 were deemed unfit for work, and we believed that work meant life, my parents changed my birthday to make me 2 years older. There were workshops in the ghetto. Some of us were tailors, dressmakers, shoemakers, bootmakers. Others made brooms, brushes, or worked in printing shop. The ghetto was overcrowded and dirty. Several families shared the small rooms. Buildings were old, for many bathrooms were outside. Water and electricity were only available at certain times. It was hard to keep clean. It was hard to keep warm. There was little food. We were starving. We had no medicine. Sickness and despairs were everywhere. Day and night, there was more horror, more terror. Soldiers stormed through the streets and the buildings, arresting people. Selections and transports to where, we didn't know. I remember that summer day when there was a roundup and my grandparents couldn't get life permits. I hid with them in the courtyard of our building under bushes and piles of leaves. We stayed there all day, not moving, while the soldiers with their bayonets searched the buildings room by room. At one time, one of the murderers was inches away from my head, but I didn't flinch. Finally, we heard the trucks leaving. The shooting ended. No more barking dogs. Slowly we crawled out from our hiding place, trying not to look suspicious. Suddenly, out of nowhere, the last patrol of the day appeared. They pushed me aside and took my grandparents away. I can still see these dear old people walking away, holding hands, never looking back. I stood there sobbing, helpless. A few weeks later at midnight, there was a banging on our door. My handsome, wonderful father was arrested and taken away. Not long after the ghetto was liquidated, that day will be etched in my mind forever. The SS troopers invaded early in the morning, their screaming and the sound of their boots filling us with terror. We were told to pack a small suitcase and leave. Small children and the elderly were kept back. My mother and I tried to take my blonde, blue-eyed, five-year-old cousin Jenny with us. When the German beat us, we were forced to leave her in the orphanage. All those left behind in the Krakow ghetto were murdered that night. Without food, without hope, just fear, we march into another nightmare, Plaszów, a concentration camp just 7 kilometers from the ghetto. It was a sleepy little village with three Jewish cemeteries. Some parents hid their small children in backpacks. Only a few of these children were successfully given to the righteous Gentiles. The rest were hidden in barracks, where they knew they were in constant danger and had to keep quiet, no matter how tired and hungry they were. Several months later, our beautiful children were discovered, loaded on trucks, and taken away. We were warned that if we move, they would be shot. My mother and I built barracks and roads paved with crushed gravestones from the Jewish cemeteries. Under the watchful eyes of Amon Gid, a vicious, sadistic murderer, every second we were in danger of being shot, hanged, or beaten to death. I was struggling just to survive when I first met Oskar Schindler. Schindler was a German industrialist who joined the SS party just to become rich. Early in 1940, he took over a pots and pans factory in Krakow. Using his charm, he intentionally befriended the SS officer, wined and dined with them, and won their affection with bribes and expensive gifts. This enabled him to get the permits necessary to run the factory and to hire the necessary workers. My mother and I were selected to work for Oskar Schindler, and we moved to the small camp he built for his workers. He paid Amon Gid a fortune for this. Her director was our savior, our guardian angel. He had a smile and a kind word for everyone, especially for the children. I was one of the youngest to be lucky enough to be on Schindler's list. Sadly, this heaven didn't last long. Orders soon came to liquidate the camp. When Plaszów was liquidated, Oskar Schindler paid Amon Gid a lot of money to move his factory and his workers to Brno, Czechoslovakia. The men on Schindler's list were shipped in one transport. The women, mistakenly, ended up in Auschwitz. It was only then that we learned that our children had been taken here and had been murdered on the day of their arrival. It was then that I lost faith in God. Most of us would have died in Auschwitz had not Oskar Schindler rescued us. He sent his beautiful secretary with a fortune in diamonds to bribe the commander. I was among the 300 women who left the death camp. My mother and I survived. Over 6 million others did not. If it weren't for Oskar Schindler, I wouldn't have had a chance to grow up, to get married, to have children and grandchildren. Oskar used his fortune and influence and risked his life to save 1,000 Jews. He and his wife, Emily, are shining examples that people can make a difference. For years, I couldn't bear to recount my own personal experience. But when the haters in this generation became more violent, and when revisionists began spreading their lies, denying that the Holocaust ever happened, I knew I could no longer remain silent. In 1946, I married Mark Finder, who is also a Holocaust survivor. We have 3 children and 6 beautiful grandchildren.
It is my distinct honor now to introduce our keynote speaker, Robert Treston, Executive Director of the Anti-Defamation League's Boston office. Robert is well known to many of you and is often the face of the ADL in rapid response to the rising number of anti-Semitic incidents in our Commonwealth and our nation. Robert is a tireless advocate for human rights generally and specifically works to combat anti-Semitism. Ladies and gentlemen, Robert Treston.
Today's commemoration is about recognition, remembrance, honor, and deep appreciation for the individuals who risked their own lives to save others during the Shoah. What matters most today, what matters more than any community gathering, is that we collectively honor the people who were murdered for no other reason other than the fact that they were Jewish. Thank you for joining today. We set this day aside each year because it is the memory, our collective memory, that serves as our inspiration, our community compass, to speak and act in ways to ensure that anti-Semitism is never allowed to take hold against our people again, and that no person or group should ever face the threat of genocide. Antisemitism remains the oldest form of hate dating back centuries. It continuously adapts to the changing environments. Antisemites quickly take every opportunity to seek out Jews and Jewish institutions, targeting them for destruction. For thousands of years, leaders and their followers have scapegoated, targeted, and blamed Jews. Conspiracy theories have always been the lifeblood of antisemitism. It was true in the years leading up to and during the Holocaust, and it remains present today. One of the key hallmarks of antisemitism is the concept that Jews control and manipulate world events at the expense of non-Jews. Global circumstances, whether war, financial crisis, or pandemic, become fertile ground for antisemitism to take hold. Beginning this past December, we could see how the coronavirus was simultaneously going to infect society with antisemitism. When the pandemic began earlier this year, a person posted on the Telegram platform, quote, "Finally, science has discovered a cure for the most insidious disease of our time, Jewishness," end quote. One of the oldest stereotypes about the Jewish people is that they have the power to manipulate global events to their benefit. One strain of this conspiracy that can be traced back to the bubonic plague is the idea that Jews purposely inflict diseases on non-Jews. I want to share some images that demonstrate this idea and these conspiracy theories. Here in this first image, you see the coronavirus depicted as a Trojan horse employed by a Jew seeking global control. In this next one, the coronavirus is literally depicted as being the Jewish people, while simultaneously implying that Jews are spreading the virus and that they are in the virus themselves. In this January Telegram message, white supremacist and former congressional candidate Paul Neelan states that China was targeted by a Jewish bioweapon designed to assert control over that country. One of the most prevalent conspiracy theories circulating is that Jews are somehow responsible for the coronavirus and are in fact profiting from it. George Soros and the Rothschild family are often invoked in connection to the virus. In this tweet from last month, March of 2020, former Sheriff David Clark says without any evidence that George Soros is somehow involved with the spread of the coronavirus around the world. And in this one, also from last month, a figure representing the Rothschilds is seen weighing money as more important than people. One of the most prevalent stereotypes about Jews is that they are greedy and only care about profit. From the first days of the coronavirus, anti-Semites have accused Jews of making money off of the virus, from either the vaccine, by exploiting market volatility, or through loans. Amongst anti-Semites and racists, the coronavirus is an opportunity for them. They want to use it as a weapon that can be used to target Jews. In this image, you can see how they bring that concept to life. Now, these are people who are constantly looking for ways to target Jews, and in this case, to get them sick and die. Everything we've talked about so far is circulating online, and most of us under normal circumstances would not be interacting with the anti-Semites who hold these views. But the coronavirus has led to a new phenomenon, Zoom bombing. These incidents have been widely reported in the media and have involved everything from religious services, online classes, to work meetings. But what strikes me as unique and scary is how extremists are actually going out of their way to find opportunities to intimidate, inflict pain, and disrupt Jewish life. You may have read that the FBI issued a public warning about Zoom bombing about a month ago. It was this Massachusetts webinar that included US Deputy Special Envoy to monitor and combat anti-Semitism, Eli Kohanim, that initiated the alert. The program was organized by the Jewish Student Union Club for high school students in Brookline, Needham, Sharon, Marblehead, and Newton. This man infiltrated the meeting, and once the program was underway and everyone was comfortable and engaged, he revealed himself by taking off his shirt to expose the swastika tattoo on his chest. ADL identified him as a well-known white supremacist who's regularly engaged in disseminating anti-Semitism and targeting Jews. We've documented hundreds of these incidents, but I want to share one more, which perhaps is the most egregious. A funeral service in Tampa was held for an elderly Jewish woman whose life was taken by COVID-19. Because of travel restrictions, family members in Rhode Island participated in the funeral via Zoom. Partway through the service, a participant shared his screen, revealing this image. I want to pause for a moment for us to reflect on the steps this individual went to do this. They had to search for the funeral, think of the image, and basically come up with a plan to disrupt a funeral with anti-Semitism. It's shocking, despicable, sad, and a reminder of what we are up against. Long before COVID-19 changed our world, we recognized that society had a memory problem, had a problem recognizing history. Now, one would think that teaching the lessons of the Holocaust in US schools would be a given, that we would not be facing these problems today. But shockingly, the data tells a different story. According to a study released in January, 2/3 of American millennials do not even know what Auschwitz is. The research has revealed that knowledge of the genocide that killed 6 million Jews during World War II is waning among American adults, particularly between 18 and 34 years old. Learning about the Holocaust and lessons of unchecked anti-Semitism and hatred are the best ways to fight prejudice and discrimination. In Massachusetts, we are pushing hard, very hard, for the passage of legislation that would require a Holocaust education for all students. This is a mandatory step for everyone. If we want to disrupt the networks and individuals who continue to target us and seek our destruction in this country in 2020, then we need more people to stand up to anti-Semitism. I began by saying that Yom HaShoah is about remembrance, recognition, and honor. But it is about one more thing. It is about making a difference. We are all capable of doing it. We all know how to do it. And we also know how the story ends when good people stand down, when good people remain silent, because we've seen the impact of silence. So now is the time to stand tall. On Yom HaShoah 2020, let us all commit to making a difference. Let us encourage others to make a difference. And let us make the world a safer and better place for everyone. Thank you.
Thank you, Robert, for those inspiring words. It is now the point in the evening where I'd like to invite Rabbi Richard Perlman to lead us in the traditional prayers of Yom HaShoah.
As I chant the El Malei Rachamim, the memorial prayer, we remember the souls, the neshamot, those innocent victims. It is customary to stand during these memorial prayers, and if you are so able to do so in your home, we stand and we remember them. We hold them in our hearts. They are with us.
kol acheinu b'nei Yisrael. Shenibuchu. V'shoah ha'nashim nashim v'tav sh'nechiku v'sh'nisrafu v'sh'nehargu sh'masru et nefsham ha'kiddush Hashem Bitzror ha'chaim et nishmoteihem Adonai hu nachlatam v'yanuchu v'shalom 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 ha'mishmoteihem Amen.
Exalted, compassionate God, grant infinite rest in your sheltering presence among the holy and the pure, to the souls of our brethren who perished in the Shoah. Men, women, and children of the house of Israel who were slaughtered and suffocated and burned to ashes. May their memory endure and inspire deeds of charity and goodness in our lives. May their souls thus be bound up in the bond of life. May they forever rest in peace. We together say, Amen. We recite now the mourner's Kaddish. Yitgadal v'yitgadash shemei rabba. V'yalma divra chirutei v'yamlich malchutei v'chayechon uv'yomechon uv'chaye d'chol beit Yisrael v'agala uv'izman kari v'yamru amen yehe shmei rabba mevarach le'olam ololmei omaya yitbarach v'yishtabach v'yipa'ar v'yitromam v'yitnasei v'yithadar v'yithale v'yithalal shmei d'kudusha barichu La'ela min kol birchata b'shirata, tushpachata v'nechemata, damiran b'alma v'yimru, amen. Yehesh lama rabba min shemaya, v'chayim aleinu v'al kol Yisrael v'yimru, amen. Oseh shalom b'mromav, hu ya'aseh shalom, aleinu v'al kol Yisrael v'yimru, amen. May the one who brings peace to his universe bring peace to us, to all the people of Israel, and especially to those precious souls. And let us together say, Amen. The state of Israel is always a place where we have hope. Atikva, the place that we go to for refuge. Rabbi Meyer and I will now lead us together in Atikva.
All old Palev Afnima Nefesh Yehudi Omiya Ulfaten Yisrachadima Sophia, for the Tikva Teinu, Tikva Bat Shnat Alpayim, Liyotam Kol Shibayim. Ha'arteinu Eretz Zion Yerushalayim Me'odam Kofi Me'arteinu Eretz Zion Yerushalayim.
Thank you for joining us remotely this evening in this most difficult time. We appreciate your attendance, and it's important that we continue to commemorate the Holocaust each year, lest we forget the universal lessons of the Holocaust. Before we sign off, I would like to thank some people who made tonight's live stream possible. Rabbis Meyer and Perlman, our musicians, all of our speakers, Preston Productions, who were amazing to work with over the past month, the Salem State Information Technology staff, including Gail Rankin, Derek Barr, and David Walker, the hardworking staff at the Center for Holocaust and Genocide Studies, Aino Akhtinen, Jess Bartel, and finally, our program director, Dan Eschett, who convinced me that this live stream was possible and worked so hard to make it a reality. And thanks to all of you who joined us. While we don't normally solicit donations at our events, if you would like to make an online donation, there's a link at the end of this show. Also, please stay tuned for the center's programs, which hopefully will begin again in the fall. Thank you very much, and good night.